Well everyone, here it is, your most asked for video. Titan. And to be fair, I can understand the curiosity towards it. It is the only moon with a substantial atmosphere. There's clear evidence of stable bodies of surface liquid on it. And best of all, mankind has visited it, so I will be able to show you a lot of real photos and video footage. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. And here is everything you could want to know about Saturn's biggest moon, Titan. But let's start from the beginning and give some context to this remarkable planet-like place. Titan is the sixth spherical moon from Saturn, and unlike Jupiter's four Galilean moons, in the Saturn system, Titan is all by itself in its size. The rest of Saturn's moons are pretty small in comparison. To give some idea of how big it is, Titan's diameter is 50% larger than Earth's moon and is 80% more massive. In fact, it's the second largest moon in the entire solar system, after Jupiter's moon Ganymede. It does actually appear slightly bigger than Ganymede if you were to put them directly side by side, but this is caused by Titan's thick atmosphere, which extends its apparent diameter. Even so, Titan's real diameter is still larger than the smallest planet, Mercury, but it's only 40% as massive. As its density is quite low for its volume, its gravity is reasonably weak, at only 0.14 g's, or 1.35 meters per second squared, which is even less than our moon. Due to Titan's low density, it is thought that its composition is half water ice and half rocky material. And like other celestial objects this size, it is believed Titan has a differentiated interior. This means it has layers. And like a lot of other large moons, one of those layers is thought to be a liquid ocean comprised of water and ammonia under the moon's crust. This liquid ocean is comparable to Earth's magma layer, situated between the core and the crust, and has been made liquid due to heat, pressure, and to a certain degree, tidal forces. The existence of this liquid layer was proven more likely when Cassini, the spacecraft orbiting Saturn, discovered extremely low frequency radio waves in Titan's atmosphere. Titan's surface is not known to be a good reflector of low frequency radio waves, but the liquid interior would be. Another reason is that the surface features on the moon have shifted by up to 30 kilometers since Cassini started observations, which could imply that the surface is not attached to the core, but is rather floating on this liquid ocean layer. And while there is no evidence of life on Titan, scientists do speculate that the conditions would be right for there to be life in this subsurface ocean. Unfortunately, if there was life to be found on the surface or below, we'll have to wait a while, as there are no planned missions to check out this possibility. And Jupiter's Europa is a more likely candidate to be investigated for life in the foreseeable future. The differentiated interior of Titan does not produce a magnetic field. Titan is still quite protected from the solar wind though, as 95% of its orbit around Saturn is within Saturn's own magnetosphere. Titan orbits Saturn once every 15 days and 22 hours, and has a rather large orbital eccentricity, which means the orbit isn't so circular. Its orbital plane is also at an angle. But that doesn't mean that Titan is likely a captured object. Rather, like Jupiter's Galilean moons, it is thought that Saturn also had several large moons in the past, but most of these had been destroyed through big collisions, which left Titan the lone victor. Saturn's medium-sized moons, like Iapetus and Rhea, are thought to be the remnants of this tumultuous beginning. Titan's day, like the day on our moon, is identical in length to its orbital period. This means Titan's rotation is tidally locked to Saturn, and only ever shows one face to the planet. Not that visually it makes any difference, Titan's hazy atmosphere completely blocks the view of the surface from an outside perspective. On the other hand, you might just be able to see Saturn while standing on Titan, although the view would be significantly obscured. This does mean, however, that if you were to stand on one spot on Titan, Saturn would never move in the sky. Removing Titan's haze, this is what it would look like. This leads us on to one of the topics that truly sets Titan apart from the rest of the moons in the entire solar system, its substantial atmosphere. I remember the first time I ever saw a photo of Titan, I was truly blown away, as it never occurred to my young self that the moon could even have an atmosphere. I thought it must have been a new planet they discovered recently or something. To me, what looks odd about the atmosphere is how far it stretches into space. When you see a picture of Earth, you see that the atmosphere has quite a tight fit around the planet. Titan, on the other hand, looks like it has a thick blanket all over it. There are a number of reasons for this. The first one is that Titan is a lot smaller than Earth, but its atmosphere is 1.9 times more massive than Earth's, or 7.3 times more massive on a per surface area basis. The second reason is that Titan's gravity is a lot weaker than Earth's, meaning it doesn't pull it down as strongly. The mass of the atmosphere actually means the pressure at the surface is 1.45 atmospheres, or 45% more than the atmospheric surface pressure on Earth. And comparing the two, you can see the extent of how far Titan's atmosphere stretches into space. 600 kilometers high is only the limit of the mesosphere. Earth's mesosphere, on the other hand, stops at 120 kilometers. Even at a distance of 975 kilometers, the Cassini spacecraft had to make adjustments to maintain a stable orbit against atmospheric drag when it made its closest approach. Like Venus, Titan is a super-rotator, meaning its atmosphere rotates faster than the rotation of the planet. This can especially be seen at the poles on the moon. Each pole has a polar vortex that rotates once every 9 hours, compared to the moon's rotation of 16 days. The vortexes on each pole seem to be like permanent hurricanes. So what does the atmosphere consist of, and why is it orange in color? Well, the atmosphere is 98.4% nitrogen, the remainder being mainly methane and small amounts of hydrogen. There are also trace amounts of hydrocarbons from the breakup of methane in the upper atmosphere due to UV light, and it is these hydrocarbons that are thought to give Titan its orange hue. This constant breakup of methane to hydrocarbons should have meant the moon ran out of methane within 50 million years, a very short space of time compared to the age of the solar system. This means there must be a source that replenishes the methane, the most likely candidate being cryovolcanoes, although biological life has not been ruled out. The methane in the atmosphere creates a greenhouse effect, without which the temperature on Titan would be a lot lower. Conversely, however, the haze also reflects a lot of the sunlight, creating an anti-greenhouse effect, which cancels out some of the potential greenhouse effect from the methane. Now, while Titan's upper atmosphere gets 1% of the sunlight Earth does due to the distance from Titan to the Sun, another result of this reflection of sunlight means the surface of Titan only gets about 0.1% in the end. The Huygens team likened the difficulty of taking photos at this light level to taking pictures of an asphalt parking lot at dusk. All these things combined means that while it would be dark, a human would only need an oxygen mask and to wrap up extremely warm to be comfortable while standing on the surface of Titan. It really is cold on Titan, minus 180 degrees centigrade on average. This means any water on Titan remains solid and doesn't ever melt, evaporate, or sublime. Then why are there sometimes clouds on Titan? Well, these are not water ice clouds, but rather methane clouds, which means yes, it can rain methane on Titan. In fact, the temperature on Titan is just right for methane to be liquid. Methane freezes at minus 182.5 degrees centigrade and boils at minus 161.5 degrees centigrade. The temperature, combined with the surface pressure, got scientists very excited at the prospect of there being hydrocarbon lakes or seas on the surface of Titan, similar to water lakes and seas on Earth. If there really were lakes on this moon, it would be the first time this had ever been observed outside of Earth. This was actually one of the main driving forces behind Cassini-Huygens, to see what there was under that thick atmosphere. The Huygens probe named after the astronomer who discovered Titan in 1655, was designed to enter Titan's atmosphere and land on the surface. The possibility of even landing on an ocean was taken into account during its design process. As the probe descended, its parachute was pulled, and after an almost 3-hour journey, it finally rested on the solid surface of Titan. Sadly, it wasn't able to see any lakes, but what it did see confirmed that methane lakes once existed, as Huygens landed on what appeared to be a dried up lake bed. These stones you see from the surface photos are rounded stones, much like pebbles found in a river or a lake on Earth. Cassini, from the perspective of space, was able to confirm that methane lakes are still found on Titan today. Near the South Pole, Cassini observed an area which was later confirmed to be a lake called Ontario Lacus. It is 20% smaller than its North American namesake, Lake Ontario. So in other words, it is still pretty big at 15,000 square kilometers. On this side of the lake, you can see a smooth shoreline eroded by waves. On the west side, you can see the first evidence of a river and delta on Titan, meaning that liquid hydrocarbons flow down higher planes to the lake, leaving delta deposits in much the same process you would find on Earth. Ontario Lacus is extremely shallow, only estimated to be between 40 centimeters and 3 meters deep, the deepest point likely to be just over 7 meters. As Cassini's radar mapped this lake, it found that the lake did not have waves bigger than 3 millimeters, meaning the surface would appear like a sheet of glass or a mirror. This doesn't mean there can't be bigger waves, unless this liquid is particularly viscous, but the likelihood is that it was simply not a windy day as the observations were taken. The atmospheric density and gravity on Titan should mean that waves would be bigger on Titan than they would be on Earth. As the North Pole of the Moon began to come out of a 15-year winter, another lake was discovered, Jingle Lacus. As Cassini was passing by the Moon, sunlight was reflected off the surface of Jingle Lacus like a mirror, directly into the view of Cassini. Upon further observation, Cassini was able to detect further evidence of moving liquid on Titan, as can be seen by these rivers flowing into the lake. The second biggest lake on Titan to be discovered is Ligia Mare. Found in the north polar region of Titan, it is bigger than Lake Superior on Earth, with a surface area of 126,000 square kilometers. While parts of this lake are reasonably shallow, the average depth is a lot deeper than Ontario Lacus at 50 meters, and some parts of it could reach depths of over 200 meters. Plenty of rivers can be seen flowing into the lake, and there are large islands found around this area here. A particularly curious observation Cassini made, dubbed the Magic Island, is the appearance and disappearance of what appears to be an island. Although scientists are unsure exactly what happened here, the theories are that it could be silt suspended in the lake, bubbles, or subsurface ice rising to the surface as the lake warmed during the moon's spring, but still very curious. The largest lake on Titan, at 400,000 square kilometers, is the Kraken Mare. As you can see, the lake is split up into two main parts, separated by a small stretch quite similar to Earth's Strait of Gibraltar. Its nickname is the Throat of the Kraken. Because of tidal forces and the size of the lake, it's thought the tide changes by about 1 meter, and so this strait may have strong currents and even whirlpools. The Kraken Mare is also quite deep in comparison to Ontario Lacus, but isn't any deeper than 170 meters. So, we know about the lakes on Titan now, but what other interesting surface features might it have? Well, plenty actually. Titan's surface is quite young, as young as 100 million years old, which means its surface must be geologically active. Some scientists believe the dirty ice crust is substantially rigid, although there is some evidence to suggest that there's tectonic activity on the moon, possibly caused by tidal forces with Saturn. The main factor of a renewed surface, however, is likely to be the same thing that produces methane in the atmosphere, cryovolcanoes. Now, this is pretty interesting. You know how magma on Earth is pretty hot? But when it comes out of the ground, it freezes. Well, Titan has the same thing, except its magma is water and ammonia. And when it comes out of the cryovolcanoes and spills over the land, it too freezes to renew the surface. Because a water and ammonia blend is a lot less viscous than lava, it flows further than lava on Earth. This means mountains are more flat and will never reach the heights of volcanoes on Earth. While it is hard to confirm specific cryovolcanoes on Titan, due to the obstruction caused by the atmosphere, the most likely candidate is Sotra Patera, found on the southern hemisphere. In this image, height has been exaggerated by a factor of 10, but it gives a good idea of the sides of the dome and the 1.7 kilometer deep pit, the largest that we know of on Titan. The force necessary for this to erupt would have had to have been incredible. And while it doesn't appear to be active now, it is being actively monitored. The fact that lava on Titan is a mix of water and other minerals means the surface could be compared to dirty ice. Because we know the Huygens bounced and wobbled in a certain way as it landed on Titan, we have a rough idea of what the consistency of the surface could be like. Scientists have referred to it as a soft, damp sand. Another theory is that it's like snow with a thin crust on top. Imagine walking on frozen snow. If you're careful, you can walk on a solid surface, but if you stomp too hard, you will sink in quite deeply. And Titan's believed to be something like this. Titan's highest mountains come in the form of ridge belts, like the Rockies in America. These ridge belts could also be a form of cryovolcanoes. The largest mountain on Titan can be found in one of these mountain ranges, known as Mithrim Mons, and is 3,337 meters high. Interestingly, mountains this tall are thought to be topped with methane snow. Also found on Titan are many gorges, valleys, and dunes. Using infrared cameras to see the surface from space, what can also be seen quite prominently are these large patches of dark terrain. Originally, these dark patches were thought to be seas until the Huygens probe landed on one of those areas, known as Shangri-La. They could well have been seas in the past, but now they are plains of dark mineral deposits, similar to the Namib Desert on Earth, where they appear as windswept dunes in some places. Overall, Titan can be compared to Earth in lots of ways. Scientists think that Titan shows signs of what early Earth could have been like, only much colder. It's fair to say that Titan is remarkably interesting, and I can only hope it gets its own mission one day. Cassini has done a great job, but it was never a Titan orbiter, and its mission will soon be over anyway. What I would find extremely fascinating is to explore more of its surface, and hopefully it won't be long until a mission to do that will be approved. Until then, here was everything you could want to know about Titan. Well, thank you so much for watching. As you might guess, this is the start of a new series I'll be doing called Our Solar System's Moons. It will be much in the same format as the Our Solar System's Planets videos, and at some point I will also do an Our Solar System's Dwarf Planets series, where I will do the next most requested video, Pluto, plus a lot more. So there's still a lot to look forward to on this channel. I hope you'll subscribe so you don't miss out, and I will see you next time.